The overflow, if you're going to go to the overflow, it's down the stairs and this way. Through the door, so that means nothing. Okay, welcome to our third science series for the season, or the school year. I want to welcome Matt Kaplan, and we are very glad he made it because last night he totally got stranded in Atlanta. So he's still operating on West Coast time. So please give him your attention and your courtesy, and welcome Matt.
Thank you. Can everybody hear me? Is this working? Yeah? Okay. I'm Matt, and I come all the way to you from Tucson, Arizona, where I work at the University of Arizona Genetics Core Facility. We do a lot of different projects in the Genetics Core Facility. We provide research support to our campus research community, as well as researchers worldwide. And over the last decade, we've gotten involved in a lot of direct-to-consumer genetic testing products and services. I'm not going to be talking about those specifically. I am incredibly biased. All the work that I'm talking about today happens in our laboratory, and there are other places to find it done as well, but not done with as much love as we give it today. What we'll be talking about today is I'm going to explain a little bit of biology. I'm going to talk about what happens in the lab, the Genographic Project that we do with National Geographic and IBM, DNA genealogy that we do with Family Tree DNA, and the DNA Shoah Project. So for the bit of biology, this is DNA in a cell. Almost all of your cells, and I do mean almost all of your cells, have DNA in them. They have the nucleus, which has chromosomes and so on. That's what you think about when you think about your DNA. We also have floating around in the goo, and that is the technical term. The goo of the cell has mitochondria. Mitochondria are like little power plants. They are organelles. And about 750 million years ago, I think, their ancestor was a little bacterial-like bug, and our ancestor was a little bacterial-like bug, and we formed this great collaborative effort. And from that, they still have their own little genome. And there we go. And so they're floating around in the cell. So how DNA works, you have in the nucleus, as I mentioned, most of your DNA. Laser pointer is dying fast. In the nucleus, you have most of your DNA. It is packed in chromosomes. Chromosomes are the equivalent to DNA of when you go to a store and you get a comforter. And it comes in that tiny little bag. And you pull the comforter out of that bag, and you will never get the comforter to fit back in that bag. That is what DNA is to a chromosome. It unravels, and it is the double helix. The double helix is two strands, and each strand is the complement for each other. The DNA alphabet is spelled out in four letters. Those letters are nucleotides, and G's go with C's, and A's go with T's. And that way, it codes for its own replication and so on. But so I'll say bases. A base is a letter, a nucleotide. I'll say base pairs, that's what I'm talking about, both strands, it's really all pretty much the same. So when you think about your genome, these are your chromosomes. Every one of us has two copies of 1 through 22. Those are the autosomes, those are really what makes us all who we are. Then there are the sex chromosomes, there is the X and the Y. Women have two X's. Men have an X and a Y. The Y is a tiny little chromosome that only has a few genes on it. And some of my slides look like they're cut off a little bit on the right side there, but that says mitochondria. And this is not to scale, because your genome is, well, actually this, with two copies of each chromosome, is over 6 billion base pairs. This mitochondria is 16,500, and it really depends where your ancestors are from, long. The Y chromosome is 60 million bases, and remember, that's million as opposed to billion, so it's actually a tiny fraction. So if you think of your genome as a set of books, it's actually, that wasn't supposed to be like that. It's actually a really big set of books. The haploid human genome, now haploid, that's half, that's one copy. The haploid genome, as in what you get from mom or dad, is 3 billion base pairs, 3 billion letters of information. So 3 billion is a very large number, and when people like me stand up in rooms like this and try to explain large numbers, it usually involves the distance from here to the moon and back, and I actually don't know how far it is to the moon and back, and I really can't conceptualize how far it is to the moon and back. So this is my best shot at how to comprehend 3 billion if you don't work in DC. 100 seconds is a minute and a half. 1,000 seconds is 16 minutes. 100,000 seconds is 28 hours. 1,000,000 seconds is 11 and a half days. So 1,000,000,000. 1,000,000 seconds is 11 and a half days. So is 1,000,000,000 a month? Is 1,000,000,000 a year? Well, 1,000,000,000 seconds is about 32 years. So in our genome, half of it, one copy, what you get from mom or dad, is 3 of those. So if I were to stand here and read off G, A, T, C at one letter per second, it would take me roughly 100 years to get through just the information you got from your mother or your father. I'm hoping this lecture will be a little bit more lively than that. But if not, I can just start reading through the G's, A's, T's, and C's. And by the way, it would take me an inordinate amount of time to find a point in that 100-year period where any of us differ. For the most part, all of our DNA as humans is identical. It is the minute tenths of percents that we differ by. And I'm not going to be specific about that because that number is changing very rapidly right now. Not that we're mutating. But 5 years ago, when we really didn't have good data towards addressing that problem, and it wasn't in sight, people would always say, oh yes, a tenth of a percent or something like that. We're actually coming close to having really good estimates for that, so I'm just going to say we're very similar and leave it at that. So if you think of a DNA sequence as a paragraph, and when I say DNA sequence, I'm not talking about a gene. I'm just talking about sort of a tangible amount of DNA, a region. It could be a gene. Most of what I'm talking about today is what we would call non-coding. In fact, when they did the Human Genome Project, one of the things that they found was that we have a lot less genes than we expected we would. We think of ourselves as grand and complex, and we are, but it turns out that we don't actually have that many more genes than a fruit fly. So if we think of a sequence like a paragraph, and in this case I have Mary Had a Little Lamb, imagine a typo, a single letter change. And in this case, Mary becomes Gary. Now this would be more of a mutation that means something, mutation in a coding region, but once again, what I'm discussing for the most part is parts that don't matter. Most of our genome, we used to say, was sort of junk filler DNA. We actually really are working on figuring out what it all means. And when I say we in that sense, I mean the big we, the scientific community. But the changes I'll be discussing are not ones that actually change anything about who you are. So Mary becomes Gary, that's a single letter change. In DNA land, a single letter change is a SNP, a single nucleotide polymorphism. And you know, it goes something like this, where there was a C, now there's a G. SNPs mutates slowly on most chromosomes and at an intermediate rate on the mitochondrial DNA. Remember, the mitochondria was that tiny little circular chromosome in that little power plant floating around in the goo of the cell. So that's one kind of mutation, a SNP, a single nucleotide polymorphism. Single nucleotide, as I mentioned, nucleotides are the letters. It's one of them, so it's single nucleotide letter. Polymorphism, poly many and morphous form. So in this population, we've gone from having one form where everybody had a C to, oh my God, someone has a G now. So a polymorphism can be where there's two things, there could be multiple changes over the history of our species where sometimes you have, some people might have an A there. But it is a site that is variable between individuals. Not everyone, whereas this site here, this A, everybody in the whole species, if you looked at that place in their genome, would have that A. So the second type of mutation I'm going to talk about is a repeated word. So in this case, in the middle of Mary had a little lamb, I've inserted the word the 13 times. These are short tandem repeats, which turns out to not be a technical term. Short as in their little words. Tandem, they're one after another, like a tandem bicycle. And repeats, they are repeated. These are called STRs. They're also called microsatellites. These are what the forensic science community uses. In a stretch of non-repetitive DNA, all of a sudden you have this little motif. In this case, it's ATG, just over and over and over and over and over again. And just like if you were to find this in the middle of a paragraph and you were to try to copy that paragraph over, and I said, I want you to copy this letter for letter, one letter at a time, but you don't get to count how many the's or ATGs there are. Hopefully, most of the time, you get 13. Sometimes you probably get 14. Sometimes you probably get 12. Maybe every once in a while, you get 15 or even 11. That's how it works in your genetic machinery when you copy all of your DNA over for every new cell. So the way these mutations happen, zap, 13 goes to 14, and it can happen like that, or 13 can go to 12. And so these little short tandem repeats, these STRs, they are tandemly repeated sequences. They're commonly between 2 and 6 bases long. When I say bases, once again, letters. So these are some examples, but certainly any possible combination of letters is fair game. And these mutate very rapidly as opposed to the SNPs that were slow to intermediate and intermediate only on the mitochondria. So genetic inheritance. So we all come from the fusion of a sperm and an egg. The egg has with it all of these mitochondria. They all come from the egg. The sperm has with it, in this case, a little blue Y chromosome. Sperm can have an X or a Y. In this case, this will be a male child. The Y chromosome, since when you have a Y, it means that you will respond to testosterone in a certain fashion and become male. Only men have Y chromosomes. And mitochondria come down, once again, with the goo of the cell. The sperm has very few. I think it's either 6 or 9 mitochondria, just enough to sort of keep that tail wiggling along. And so the mitochondria come from mom, where the Y chromosome comes from dad. And so here I have a genealogy of gingerbread people. You can tell gingerbread men have blue buttons and gingerbread women have pink buttons. My gingerbread men have Y chromosomes, and everybody has mitochondria. Without mitochondria, you could not live. But the mitochondria comes down maternally. The Y chromosome comes down paternally. So if we look at paternal ancestry, down from great-great-great-granddad to granddad to father to son, and mitochondria came down from great-grandma to grandma to mom to daughter. So I have here 2 parts of the genome, and really remember the Y is 60 megabases, 60 million letters long, which once again out of billions is a tiny amount, and the mitochondria is only 16,000. So these are small fractions of the genome, but they do trace these 2 very specific lines of inheritance. The human Y chromosome can be traced all the way back to Africa 80 to 100,000 years ago. The human mitochondria can be traced all the way back to Africa closer to 150 to 180,000 years ago. With these 2 pieces of DNA, once again, I can trace all the way back, but I don't say anything about these folks in the middle. Granted, that's where the majority of the DNA is not about these 2 lineages, but these 2 lineages I can trace specifically to specific individuals. So how this all works, I have up here a little gingerbread man and his cartoon Y chromosome. Over time, as he passes on his Y chromosome, mutations accumulate. This son got the Y chromosome, same exact copy as dear old dad. This son picked up one change. And it could be a SNP, it could be a microsatellite, the SDRs, any kind of change. And as they have sons and pass them on, these two, you'll have to take my word that he has the same chromosome as his dad. These two have the same chromosome as their dad with that mutation. This one gets another perfect copy. This one has another change. And another generation goes by, and we have some new mutations and the old ones being passed on. Here's another mutation, this pink one, being passed on the background of the red. And so on. And so, as mutations accumulate, generation after generation, they accumulate in, shall we say, a hierarchical fashion. As in, this black mutation fell on the background of this blue mutation. And individuals whose Y chromosomes, or same thing works for mitochondria, individuals whose DNA is more similar, most likely share more recent common ancestry. And if you look at enough DNA, you can say that for certain. So by looking at individuals from the current generation, we can do the jigsaw puzzle and reconstruct all the relationships. And if we ask them where they're from, as we go around the world and we collect DNA from people and we read these different portions of their genome, we can construct figures like this. This is a figure I have borrowed from the Genographic Project. In blue here, we have all of the major migration routes of the human Y chromosome over the last 50 to 80,000 years. And in gold, we have all of the major migration routes of the human, traced by the human mitochondria over the same time span. And I'll be getting to that later. So that was all of the boring molecular biology. Now on to how we actually do this. Working in a research lab is a lot like cooking. It's actually also a lot like being a carpenter or what have you. It's a lot of moving stuff around, heating stuff up, cooling stuff down. The science comes in from knowing when to move it, when to heat it, when to cool it, and when to mix it. So what happens in the laboratory? First, I'd like to mention this is my team. This is Arizona Research Laboratory's Division of Biotechnology. There are people in here who are doing computational stuff. There are people here who are doing wet lab stuff. Some people have sort of one foot in both worlds. Doing this kind of work in this day and age is a lot of driving big computers and robots and fancy, expensive technology. And so for us, it all starts with a swab. I heard that the chocolate people might bring samples. I work on spit, so I'm not going to share. But people swab. This is there's a little cottony, papery brush head here. You rub the inside of your cheek, you pop it into the tube, and you mail it to our laboratory. Every week, we get shipments of samples. We currently average between 1,500 to 1,600 samples a week. Since we do a lot of direct-to-consumer stuff, during holiday season, we can have 3,000, 4,000 samples in a week. And it's exciting. So how we do this is we have sample sorting with barcodes and LIMS. LIMS is Lab Information Management Systems. They're the computers I was talking about. So as samples show up in the lab, we shoot them with the barcode reader. The computer says that person's sample goes in those coordinates, and someone puts it in those coordinates in the endless sea of racks of racks of racks. All of the samples that come through the lab are just numbers to us. It is a giant blind test for us every week. And with probably about 50% of the people whose DNA samples we're testing are genealogists. And the genealogists test one family member after another, and they know what the results are that they're expecting. We have a lot of different stopgaps in place to make sure we don't mix up samples. In this business, when you mix up samples, you are making a statement about someone's mother's honor. And we try to avoid that. So how do we read the genome? Well, first off, we don't. As I mentioned, the genome is this huge amount of information, and we want only a fractional aspect of these tiny pieces. We're only reading a few different little spots, I guess 60 to 100, depending, of the Y chromosome. And we're only reading about 1,000 letters of the mitochondrial genome, although now we can do the whole thing. But for the average person that submits a sample, we do 12 places on the Y chromosome, and we do 500 letters of the mitochondria. And so we don't read it. We take just little pieces of it. And those pieces we know enough about to be able to infer a lot about ancestry. And so, But anyway, here I am back to my books. So to read the genome, we tear out the pages. And so we tear all the bindings off. A lot of people ask, are you going to clone me? Well, first off, if I was going to clone anyone, I would clone me, because I have a more than a full-time job. But also, the fact that we extract the DNA by tearing all the chromosomes apart and shredding it down would make that impossible as well. But so how this works, here are some cells, and we go through this process called DNA extraction. We end up with a pile of DNA. And how this works is first we digest the cells. This is sort of the DNA crop pot. We have in each one of these tubes someone's cheek swab. We add what is basically meat tenderizer, and then we put them in a rotisserie oven that rotates end over end at about 55 degrees Celsius, which is like a crop pot, overnight. And by the next day, we have DNA soup. We then have automated DNA isolation robots. And these robots do DNA isolations much like doing laundry from washtub to washtub. And I realize for most of this audience, you have no idea what that means, but I refuse to explain it. So how this all works is that we have these robots. Each one of these blocks here has 96 different wells. Each well is like a separate tube. They do not mix together. And we have 96 little magnetic rods, and this is on a robotic arm. And what you can't see in the block right here are actually 96 hollow probes that those magnets fit into. And so how this all works is we start off with the cell. We crack the cell open. That's called lysis. We then have the DNA that we want and cell debris. We have these great little metal beads. They have a metal core, and they are covered with silica that's basically glass, except for it costs more. And with the right salts, DNA and glass have a certain attraction for one another. And so the DNA sticks to the glass bead. Since it has a metal core, we're able to go in there with a magnet and pull it out. So we can just, we put a handle on the DNA, and we can pick it all up. And then we move it to another tube, and we drop it off. And as we move it from tube to tube to tube, we wash it, and so on. And then we move it to a final solution where the DNA doesn't have any, there's no more salt to make the DNA stick to the glass bead. So the DNA falls off of the bead. We pull the beads out, and we have just clean DNA in a tube. It's actually in one of the wells of that deep well block. And so we're going to see how this works. So here is the deck of the robot. These are the rods, the magnetic rods, and you will see here there are probes. I'm going to see if this actually works out. So the robot's going to start, it's at the end of a cycle of mixing, so all the beads hit the DNA, and then it's going to plunge down in with the magnets, pull out the beads, and move to the next position. So it's churning, it's like 96 little butter churns in there, and now it's getting ready. The magnetic rods are going into the rod covers. The whole thing is going to go down, 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 down. And so as it's descending, all of those silica-coated, now covered with DNA, beads are sticking to the magnetic rods. Now it's going to pull up. It's going to be a little drip shield over here that flips under, so there's no chance of drips and contamination. And there we go. And it moves. And that's how it drops it off in the next spot. We have five of these robots. We run them all side by side by side, and we can extract DNA from about 1,500 samples in a single day. And yeah, as it drops off the beads, it starts to churn and mix them all up again and wash them off in the next batch. And then we have all these DNAs. They're cleaned up. They're in these deep well blocks. Well, then we have thousands and thousands of DNAs. And at this point, actually, our lab has tested over 500,000 people's DNA. And we store them all in little trays like this. So we isolate them in deep well trays, store them all in little trays like this, because as soon as you have that many DNAs, you can no longer be moving them around by hand. You need to have robots. And so this is the deck of one of our larger robots. All of these trays have people's DNA in them, 96 8 by 12 spots per tray. And the robot is going to reach into one tray, take the lid off, and pull out a single sample and put it into this other type of tray, just a tiny little drop, for how we do the testing. And so the head that has the gripper arm is right here. It's picking up the tray, brings it over. And we have six of these robots. And here's the other arm. It's picking up a tip. It's got the tip. It's going to the exact coordinates of one sample. It's pulling out that sample, and it's going to transfer it to the appropriate place in this tray for testing. So most of all of this work, the hardest part is keeping up with the volume of samples and making sure not to mix them up. Testing 500,000 people's DNA is a nice trick. Testing 500,000 people's DNA and giving them each their own results, that's sort of where the magic is. So after we've transferred the DNAs into these trays, we do the polymerase chain reaction, PCR, which with Law and Order and all these different criminal shows, I think everyone has a sense of what PCR is. It's what forensics people do. Well, for us, PCR, it's the DNA Xerox machine. So if you think back to that paragraph, in this case, this would be the first few words of the paragraph. This would be the last few words of the paragraph. We actually buy the complementary DNA sequences, just about 20 letters long. You order them on the internet, and they show up in 2 days. And we buy them with little fluorescent tags, and we can make copies of just that given paragraph. We run it through this fancy capillary electrophoresis machine, which on CSI and such, they also use for analyzing paint. But it's really a DNA sifter. It sorts out the DNA by size, and this is what comes out the other end. This is what the data actually looks like. This is three graphs of three different colors. We have yellow, we have green, we have blue. And over here are small pieces. This is my smallest thing. It is the locus name, the place, the address in my genome is 426. And in this case, the number of repeats, remember this is an STR, this has repeated words, is 11. If the number of repeats were 12, it would be over here. It would be a little bit longer. So with all these things, different colors and different sizes, I can run a dozen or so different places on my Y chromosome. I know, once again, this is the place is 439. The number of repeats in that repeated word is 13. If it was 14, it would be over here. If it was 12, it would be over here. I've made copies of all these different spots, and I run them through the sieve, and I read them with a laser. One other aspect. When we started doing all of this work in larger throughput, we had to add this one other place. This is not a variable point in the genome. This is called a mulligenin. It has one size for the X and one size for the Y, because one of the hard things to communicate in a DNA testing program of this magnitude is that women don't have Y chromosomes. And so in order to not keep testing women for Y chromosome markers, we put this one in. When we get a sample that has just noise and just a single peak for the X, it means it's got two X's and no Y, it's a female sample. Well, this is working out fine. 104 letters long is an X chromosome. Well, we were doing this. We got this one's 104. That's what we expect. We got one that was 100. Now, the Y is actually over here at about 110. We couldn't figure out what would be 100. We retested the second swab of the sample. One of the guys in the lab is very creative, and he ran a novel control, GBG155100, and it matches down to a tenth of a letter, or a hundredth of a letter. And it turns out that GBG155100 was his dog, Ivan. So we tested over 500,000 people and two dogs. And yes, I cannot tell you your dog's ancestry, but there are groups who claim to be able to. That's what the Y chromosome data looks like. The mitochondrial data is much more simple. We just have all of these peaks, and each peak is one letter longer than the other, and you read it from small to big, and you get the sentence. In this case, the paragraph that is that piece of mitochondria. Okay, so now that you've seen this long, arduous process of how we do this, this is how most people think it works and why people call me a day after they've sent their sample and want to know what their answer is.
Are those the samples for the DNA build?
Yeah, no, I'm just ready for the 310. I've got one more sample for you. You worked in here in Natalia, you know the evidence submissions are processed in order, so you can wait for the next run. Valera, one of those pictures is of my sister. That reads a jump. Please compare this against these other samples. I'm sorry, I just do it now, okay?
This is the DNA isolation, the robot work, and the PCR right here with that scissors. And yes, we use huge beakers of biochemical reagents for each and every sample. That is the right kind of machine. That's the younger sibling of ours. And that's how it works. And that piece of paper says, it's your sister.
Girl in the toll booth car,
it's
my sister.
But yeah, so that is the perception that we have to deal with. It's actually, I'd rather be a molecular biologist wondering, having people wonder why I'm so grossly incompetent than to actually be a prosecutor in this day and age. So that's all the nuts and bolts of it. Now, what does it actually mean? So I produced this string of numbers for my Y chromosome. I produced this string of letters for my mitochondria. And so the first project that, that I'm going to talk about is the Genographic Project. The Genographic Project, as I mentioned, is a collaboration with National Geographic and IBM. It has three major phases. It has field research, public participation and awareness campaign, and the Genographic Legacy Project. So the field research, there are a dozen labs around the world. Mine is not one of them. Each studying indigenous peoples of their own region. This is a major international collaboration. This is our last chance to get a really good snapshot of what DNA signatures look like from different peoples of the world. In really likely one more generation, everyone will be from one major urban center or another. And the ability to tie people's genetic signatures to geographic landscapes will be gone. And without that, we will not be able to reconstruct the history of humanity. The public participation and awareness campaign, that's what we work on in my laboratory. We work on that in collaboration with Family Tree DNA. And if you go to National Geographic's website and you buy a DNA test kit, it will show up in my laboratory and we will do those procedures on that and you will get your genographic experience. This is an opportunity for people to see how they fit into what you read in the textbooks. And then the Legacy Project takes some of the funding from the public participation samples. That is a fee for service. The proceeds from that go to the Legacy Project and go to support the field research. Legacy Project just provides grants and aid to indigenous peoples of around the world. For language documentation, for buying books, for whatever different people from different regions need. This is the tree of all modern human Y chromosomes. This is the tree of all modern human mitochondria. When you know where everyone's from, you can put them on the globe like this. This is the genographic, this is sort of the flagship figure. This is the story of our history. This is the story about how we all originate in Africa. 100,000 plus years ago, we all started to leave Africa within the last 50 or so thousand years. If you go to the Genographic Project website, whether you participate or not, it's a wonderful website. It's won a lot of different awards. And my favorite part of it is the Atlas of the Human Journey. And as you click through, this is a little timeline up here. This is 60 to 200,000 years ago. You can see some mitochondrial branches. All of those little blobs are points of archaeological interest. And as you click through time, here we have glaciers forming, some mitochondrial lines are starting to leave Africa. Further down, now we're at about 30,000 to 35,000 years ago, more spreading around, and so on. And this is what a genographic report looks like. This is my Y chromosome. My ancestors started with all of yours in Africa and left Africa about 50,000 years ago. My ancestors settled in the Middle East, stayed there from probably about 40,000 years ago till about 20,000 years ago. They were associated with populations that developed agriculture and then spread out across the Mediterranean and North Africa. On my mother's line, and I'd like to be clear that you get one test or the other. You can order them both, but you don't get both for one geographic experience. My maternal line, once again, we all start in Africa, ended up through Central Asia, and then at the end of the last glaciation, entered into Europe, where it became one of the dominant mitochondrial lineages there. And when I say dominant, some would say most common. Then how genealogists are using this data. Now, I would like this to not be a big commercial for Family Tree DNA. We work with Family Tree DNA. Family Tree DNA does have the largest database, but there are a bazillion other places that you can go and have this work done. But there's only one place you can go and have this work done by me. So what people are wondering about when they come to us generally is, who do I match, where am I from, and are we related? And what I like to say is all it takes is a DNA sample and the largest database of test results in the world. Last I heard, Family Tree's database was 6 times the size of all the other databases combined. And so how this all works out is, this is Family Tree's homepage. As of yesterday, there were 202,000 Y chromosome records and almost 125,000 mitochondrial records. And so how this works is, my DNA is in there, I log in, and I can see my DYS values. This, once again, just all those numbers that I showed you on the graph. They don't mean anything to me than they do to you. But what they do mean is, when you put them all in a database full of genealogists who are looking for relatives, well, Y chromosomes, like surnames, are passed down from father to son. So the Y chromosome is a very powerful genealogical tool. So when I look for my matches, what I get is a list of names and emails. This is a base 12 marker test. These are exact matches. 12 markers means I'm looking at 12 different places. I can look at 25 different places. At 25 markers, I have no exact matches. I have a genetic distance of 1. That means that these people at one of those 25 different places, I have a 14, they have a 15, or I have a 14, they have a 13, we're one step apart. And once again, these are their emails. I've obscured them to protect people that are my kin. But yes, what this is really is a dating service for genealogists. And what you can see in parentheses next, and this is my 25 marker result, it shows that these people have upgraded this person to 67, this person to 37, so that if I wish to upgrade, I can see if I still match them or if I should save my money, because if they don't have more data for me to compare to, I'm not going to match them at a higher level if they haven't tested for that. As you test for more and more parts of your Y chromosome, you get a finer and finer resolution result. So this is 25 and 37 and 67 markers. My closest matches are two steps away. One other thing you can do, there's this little icon here on the corner. When you click that, now here's Sam and Joe are my two closest matches. If I click on this button for Sam, I see this chart, and this gives me the cumulative Bayesian likelihoods, the odds basically, that we share a relation within 4, 8, 12, 16, 20, 24, 28 generations. And what that means is that 4 generations, we have a 46% chance of sharing an ancestor. That's a coin toss. At 8 generations, it's 85%. By 12, it's 97% chance that we share an ancestor within that window. For Eugene over here, going just two steps further away, at 4 generations, we're only 10%. Before, we were almost 50. At 8, we're up at about 50%. At 12, we're at the 80%. So there actually is a lot of power in every single one of these changes. And then I can look at my ancestral origins. The nice thing about genealogists is they know where they're from, and they know where their ancestors are from. So when I look for my ancestral matches at 12 markers, in case it wasn't obvious to you all, I'm a Jewish guy from New York. And so, yes, all these people have commented that they're Ashkenazim, which means they're Eastern European Jews, and they're from Eastern Europe. And this is at 12 markers. As I go through 25, it's even homing in on more Eastern of Eastern Europe. And so on, 37, 67, my only really good markers are Poland and Romania, and that's actually where my ancestors are from. Moving on to the mitochondria. Looking at the results of the mitochondrial work. First off, what do I see? Instead of all the numbers, I have a few letters. The letters are really distilled down to, for that whole 500 and something letters of the first part of the mitochondria, what it comes down to me is one letter, 16,519 C. I'll explain that in a minute. And for the second part, another 500 some odd letters, it comes down to 263G, 309.1C, 315.1C. What that means is when I look at sort of the reference, the benchmark sequence, out of all of this, I match the benchmark sequence exactly. At this one place, here there's a red T. That's where instead of that T, I have a C. Here, there's a red A. Where that red A is, I have a G. And these other ones here, and this one's a little cut off, those had decimal places because there's an extra letter inserted in the text, in mind, compared to this reference. These are all very common. As I mentioned, I have the very common mitochondrial lineage of Europe. And so when I look at my matches, once again, I'm sort of the poster boy for European lineage. And so when I look at my low resolution, as in only the first 500 letters, I match 9,246 people. Not exactly people I'm going to be sending holiday cards to. When I look at the high resolution matches, I match 1,700, still a lot. As of this morning, I finally got my full mitochondrial genome sequence, which there are two things going on. First of all, only about 10% of the folks in the database have done this step, although more and more every day. But even at 10%, at my highest resolution, I had 1,700 people. So you'd still expect about, if all things were just the sampling issue, you'd still expect about 170. I only have these 5. That's pretty cool. That's the highest resolution that the mitochondrial DNA will do. You can't get more data than sequencing the complete mitochondrial genome for maternal lineages. Then for my ancestral origins, for low resolution, it's pretty much a flavor of everywhere the British Empire has ever been. Sun never sets on my mitochondrial lineage. And for high resolution, still a little more. And by the way, this is just the first page of it. It goes on for most of the countries in the world. But when we get up to this high resolution, actually, all I have is Austria, Poland, and parts of Russia. And one person has actually declared that they're Ashkenazi. So that's actually interesting data. And for most people, well, actually for most people will have common lineages, that's why they're common. Most people will not have something quite as common. As I said, I am the worst case scenario for finding relatives on a mitochondrial line. Oh, a few case histories of the genealogy. We had a family that had been in the US for 80 years. They went on vacation to Hungary. It was really genealogical expedition. They went to the village that they traced their ancestry from. They met a family with the same surname. They ordered a test. And out of 12 markers, they are one step apart. Those are relatives. Here we have another family where in 1492, they were exiled from Spain. Half of the family went to Greece. Half of the family went to Holland, then to England, then to Jamaica, and finally settled in the US. This is 37 markers. Oh, by the way, it's not colored, they're the same. This is a single step. These are 15s as opposed to 16s. This part here, the tail of our 37 marker panel, those are our fastest moving markers. And this is a story of about 500 years. This is exactly what you would expect. This is a match. This is a family. And this one's my favorite because it's a little bit sinister. The names have been changed to protect the guilty. A member of the Smith family matched the Jones family. After sharing family histories, they found one line of the Jones family had been told two generations ago that the father had died, but he had actually moved to the other side of the state where he started a new family under the name of Smith. Can't hide from DNA. Okay, and now, this is Bennett Greenspan and Max Blanco, the president and vice president of Family Tree DNA. This is the newest thing in this field. Sex doesn't matter anymore. I'm going to leave that alone, actually. But what they mean is that technology is evolving, and we're well past just Y chromosomes and mitochondria. We can now do these full genome SNP scans, so you can learn a lot. It's messy, and I'm going to give a little bit of the biology behind this all. So if we think about continuing our book analogy, if we have our Y chromosome is sort of a little pamphlet, and our mitochondria is just a single page, each one of our chromosomes is a stack of books. And I mean each one. So this, what I have here representing, a pair, really is there's one of these for each one of each pair, a pair of these for each pair of those. And so how this all works is that, yes, for the Y and the mitochondria, Y doesn't match up with the X. The mitochondria has nothing to match up with at all. They don't swap pieces around every generation. But from this man, he will create sperm that do and don't have Y chromosomes. But every one of these sperm will have different mixtures of each of the chromosomes that each of his parents had. So I don't pass on the chromosome 1 that I got from my mom or my dad. I pass on a mosaic of both. So these are some possible sperm. There's sort of an infinite number of possibilities. Each autosome in the sperm is a mixture of each of the parent. Same for the eggs, whereas they will never contain a Y because they're from a female lineage. They will always have the mitochondria, but then there will be a different mosaic of the autosome. That's what I just said. And so, how this all works is when these two get together, this is the chromosome that he got from mom and the mitochondria that he got from mom. This is the Y that he got from dad. And the chromosome, remember, this is for all of those 22 pairs. But they're mosaics. And so, and when this other couple gets together and they have this daughter, mom's mitochondria, but then mosaic of the parental chromosomes. And then by the time you get down to here, to the grandchild, we now have portions of all of the grandparents. We still have dad's Y chromosome, and we still have mom's mitochondria. But the rest of this is a big jumble. And so, yes, a child has 50% of each of his parents, and each of their parents, and so on. The grandchild is related, on average, 25% to each grandparent. But what we have with all this is a dilution of 50% per generation. Now, once again, we're dealing with 6 billion. That's a large number. That's a lot of information. So the diluting it down every generation still works, but it is not as simple a system as we share a great grandfather or we share a great grandmother. That said, this is where the majority of your genome information is. This is where the majority of your ancestors are. As you go back a few generations, you still have one Y chromosome and one mitochondria per generation, but that breadth of folks in between keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. But it's big computing sorted out. And with that, I'm going to move on and close with the DNA Shoah Project. The DNA Shoah Project is a project that we run out of the laboratory with no private partner. Where we are doing using forensic technologies to reunite families separated by the Holocaust. This is our webpage, and the important thing to know is that the DNA Shoah Project is building a database of genetic material from Holocaust survivors and their immediate descendants in the hopes of reuniting families disrupted by the Holocaust. Participants' anonymity is assured, as much as is possible in this day and age, but I will say that we have a monstrously great team of computer support. And there is no fee to participate. This is a humanitarian service project. You remember all of your chromosomes? Well, these are where all of the different STR markers, microsatellites, that we are using for this project are across the genome. It is not a genome snapshot. That is what is being done for some of these other family finder and such tests. Those are SNP tests. This is a forensic standard project, and this is the largest set of forensic markers in use by any project anywhere. We are, I believe, the first adopter of the National Institute of Standards and Technology's newest marker set. We also have put together this is our website again, a piece for educators, where we have an educational module with a survivor testimony. We have a CD genetics lesson. We have forensics lessons. And we have student activities and, most importantly, a teacher's guide. This is a curriculum this is the first ever Holocaust-relevant curriculum to be taught in a science classroom. But with the teacher's guide, it can actually also be taught by an ambitious humanities teacher. And with that, I made it through 121 slides. I'll take questions. And thank you all for your attention. Yes, questions? So the question was, what about the accuracy and the reliability? I will start off by saying that any process that involves humans will have an error rate. That said, we have tried over the last decade to remove all points of human error. Everything that we can think of, we have ruled in the lab. We get fooled by everything exactly one time. Everybody will have mistakes and failures in the point, but we have put in currently every single double check that we've experienced and can foresee. One of the major, and I will not cast names out there, one of the major direct-to-consumer testing groups had an issue where 96 people got the wrong result about 6 months ago. Each tray of DNA has 96 samples. And if you rotate it 180 degrees, it will still fit in every one of your machines, and you will give 96 people the wrong results. In our trays, we have randomly placed by the computer blanks, so that each tray has its own fingerprint of failure. There are samples that are in there that have water in them, so that we read each tray to make sure. Actually, 5% of all of our samples that we run are controlled. That said, each score is checked by two computer algorithms, two separate software packages, and two pairs of human eyes. None of the robots move without people shooting a barcode. It is, will there be errors? Absolutely. And especially with the genealogy business, as I mentioned, we don't know what the results should be. Our clients do. Every week we do basically hundreds, if not thousands, of blind tests. And so far, we're doing pretty well. That said, false paternity in our society is estimated at a conservative 1 in 10. By the way, for those of you not so quick on the math, that means in this room there are between 25 and 30 people who the person they call dad isn't. But anyway, question here? What's our timetable for results? Yeah. Ah, so the question was, so I showed you all this, and then I showed the movie to show that it does not happen in 60 seconds. How long does it actually take? If I have only one sample to run and I drink a lot of caffeine and don't need to sleep, I can turn a sample around in under 48 hours. But that's one sample. If we're going to do, as we do in our laboratory, rounds of row, row, row your boat, where every Thursday it starts anew with another 1,500 to sometimes 4,000 samples, it takes about a month. Yeah, which I'm happy to say I've bought DNA tests from a lot of the other groups myself, just for curiosity's sake, and we're about twice as fast as the other group. In the back, you're going to have to speak up.
How closely related to or based off of the Human Genome Project are your processes?
How closely related are we to the Human Genome Project? We work on humans. We use a lot of the same gear, and that's about it. We use some of that data, but the Genographic, especially, I'd like to be clear, has nothing to do with the Human Genome Project. Neither does any of the work that we do. Further said, we are a university core services laboratory. We do provide support for a lot of different academic research projects. Some of them may have ties into that type of work. I'm sure they do. No, just the fact that we work on human DNA, that's about the amount of overlap. Yes, here at the front.
I came here because in the newspaper advertisement there was a statement that this was you alluded briefly at the beginning to the fact that you're tracing back to the beginning, down in Africa. So my question is, where do you get the DNA to know that?
So the question is, when I throw out these outlandish numbers of hundreds of thousands of years and humans in Africa, I'm taking a little poetic license. Where do we get the DNA from those folks? Well, we don't do ancient DNA. I have friends who do ancient DNA. It's a terrible way to live. Whereas I do thousands of samples a week, they do one sample, and they work on it for weeks and weeks or months and months, and often you get nothing. Or you get your own profile, which is even more embarrassing. Very, very common. How does this all work? What we do is we study across the diversity of current human populations. And with that, we can infer back in time. There is something to be said for basically, metaphorically speaking, the breadth of diversity of a population is actually very tightly correlated to the depth in time that you can read back to common ancestry. There's a statistical aspect called the coalescence where these lineages connect. But really, from looking at the diversity across populations, we do a lot of math. and a lot of computer processing, and we can actually reconstruct what the ancestral states must have been to have the diversity that we see around us today.
Can I follow up? In the Egyptian, that famous Egyptian museum in Cairo, they have the number of mummies, and then the that famous family that dug up the bones of. I forget their name right now, but anyway, they were able to find human remains. Is there any viable DNA possibility from them?
So the follow-up question was, what about the mummies and the Iceman and even isn't there Svante Paabo at Max Planck doing the Neanderthal genome? And the answer to all those is absolutely. And those are very useful for checking in with how all of our statistics and such, does this all fit? Does this all make sense? I mean, we use evidence from all sorts of other fields, including ancient DNA, including just plain old archaeological research. We show in our DNA evidence that people must have been here at time X. Are there any traces of actual people being there at that time and so on? We do calibrations against the archaeological record and so on. All of that in no way is molecular biology or human population genetics here to do it all on their own and say this is truth. This is a synthesis of what is known. And so all of that stuff falls in together.
Can we thank our speaker one more time for tonight's lecture, please? And if you have other questions for Dr. Kaplan, please feel free to come down and speak to him in person. And if you need the extra credit, again, that's by the front door on your way out. Thank you for coming tonight.
Probably not.
Hey! Did you go down?
Yes.
Did you get it?